Dr. Christopher Nicolet. Dr. Nicolet works in the development of software for the control of hydroelectric power plants. He also studies the dynamic behavior of hydroelectric units by synchronizing electromechanical components for the hydro energy exploitation. Welcome back.
Thank you very much. So, good afternoon, everyone. So, it's a great pleasure for me to be here today, and thanks to the organizing committee to giving me the opportunity to be here and to give this presentation today. I'm sorry, I'm not able to speak Spanish. I would love to, but I don't know a single words.
Tu as demandé que tu étais capable de reparler en allemand, mais ils n'en veulent pas voulu.
Ah, d'accord. So we will switch to English this afternoon. But so I will talk about variable speed pump storage power plant. This is a technology that is developing more and more, as it features quite significant interest, especially for grid stability purposes. And I will try to give some example and some insight on this technology this afternoon. So I will first very shortly introduce our company, Power Vision Engineering. Then I will present you the general context about new renewable energy integration. Then I will present the most common technology of pump storage power plant, the pump turbines, but then with a focus on variable speed motor generators. We could have two different types of electrical arrangement, either using a full-size frequency converter or to use asynchronous machine, as it was shown also this morning by Professor Avalan. And I will then give some words about the Simpson software that belongs to EPFL and enables to simulate quite well pump storage power plant with variable speed units. And I will then give some examples of applications related to pump storage power plant with variable speed. And I will first illustrate the dynamic performances of such unit, then to show how it could improve grid stability. And I will show one case of fast transition using full-size frequency converter, and also some power generation, isolated power network with high share of wind and solar, and see how the pump storage can balance the wind and solar power. So very briefly, our company is named Power Vision Engineering. This is a spin-off from the PFL, founded in 2007. We have six employees with PhD degrees in the field of hydraulic, mechanical, electrical, and civil engineering. And we have strong collaboration with Laboratory for Hydraulic Machines and formerly with the Laboratory for Electrical Machines. And this is our sister company active in civil engineering. We have an agreement with the EPFL to distribute and sell the Simpson software, and we provide also training seminar, but we also ensure the support. We also provide engineering services about transient analysis. We do more and more system stability, including the power network, and time to time we do also some CFD. So the general context, I think all of you know this typical trend of increase of need of electricity. And in the electricity mix, the share of renewables tends to increase in the future year, we hope for this. Even so, as Professor Avalan mentioned this morning, the coal is still a huge share, and natural gas also. These numbers stands for Europe for now. So there will be a big increase of new renewable energies. The difficulty of integrating these new renewable energies is the fact that they are intermittent, so they are changing according to the wind, to the sun. And here is a record over 7 months in Germany. It's a bit old, but the trend remains the same. This is the wind power generation And here in yellow behind is the PV solar power generation. In 2010, and I think these numbers have almost doubled, I would say, as a first guess nowadays, the peak power generation of wind power was 20 gigawatt, and the peak power of photovoltaic was 10 gigawatt. So altogether, the peak power generation of new renewable could be as high as 30 gigawatts. So you need some other energy sources to balance this energy power generation. To do the balance, we rely on some power networks services to provide some frequency control. So in case there is an event on the power network and which induce a frequency drop in the power network, we first use the primary reserve that we should activate in 30 seconds. Then it is replaced by secondary reserve that should be activated in about 5 minutes and last for about 15 minutes. And after 15 minutes, it is replaced by tertiary reserve so that we can restore the primary and secondary reserve. This is why these names also work quite well. I think now the new definitions for primary, secondary, and tertiary control from NTSO is frequency containment reserve to contain the frequency deviation, frequency restoration reserve to restore the primary reserve, and replacement reserve to replace these two. So now the challenge is to provide all these services, because hydropower have this big advantage of being able to provide all these services due to high flexibility. So indeed, new renewable energy are intermittent generation source. Normally, they do not contribute to this primary and secondary control. They don't have inertia. A PV cell doesn't have any inertia. And it requires also storage and substitution capacity. This is why it goes very well. The integration of this energy goes very well with the integration of pump storage power plant, which are able to provide high flexibility and wide operating range. They usually have quick response time, and they are able to provide primary and secondary control capability. Tertiary control, almost all energy sources can provide, but primary and secondary control are the most difficult to provide, and hydropower is highly qualified to provide these services and to improve the stability of the power network. And pump storage can store the excess of energy. If you have storage, conventional hydro, it's nice because you can adapt your generation, but still you cannot store if you have too much wind or too much PV. And it was said this morning, the global efficiency between pumping and turbining, the overall efficiency is about 70 to 80%. Here are some typical power network events which have all different time scales. If we start from, let's say, from the macro view, we could have a look at the energy management at the week level. Then we can have the energy management at the day level or hour level. Then we have transmission congestions on the power network at the hour level. Then there is the operating reserve, spinning reserve with time scale between the seconds and hours, loading following, regulation, voltage stability, grid fault, and at very low time scale we have grid harmonics. Actually, pump storage power plant can provide services in this range of time frame from the milliseconds up to the week, and maybe even further than the week. So it represents a big potential to support the power network stability. Moreover, if we have a look at the evolution of the duration versus the available power. So it's the duration during which you are capable to deliver the energy or to store the energy. The hydropower is one of the highest technology that is capable to deliver power for hours, even weeks, at full capacity, which represents some gigawatts. At the opposite, you will have the super cap, for example, that have little energy, but they can deliver it in very short time. With respect to cost, if we look at the cost per megawatt and the cost of the energy per megawatt hour, the good news is also it's a very cheap storage solution. I like to show this example of pump storage development. This is the case of Portugal. It has been presented in 2011. And I think it's quite interesting case. As we can see here, that was the forecast in 2011 of the increase of new renewable in Portugal, plus 38%. The major part of this increase was supposed to come from wind. And to counterbalance this increase of new renewable energy, Portugal had a very clear energy development strategy. The strategy was to decrease the contribution of thermal power plants up until 2020. So that's the evolution between 2012 up to 2020. So they wanted to decrease by 22% the contribution of thermal energy sources, to increase the new renewable by 38%, and to accommodate this increase of new renewable and reduction of thermal power, they plan to increase the pump storage capacity by plus 156%, from installed capacity at that time was 1.2 gigawatts up to 3.2 gigawatts, and also to increase the conventional hydro capability. So here is a test case where I think REN in Portugal has made a clear analysis of the needs for pump storage power plant to be able to integrate such a large share of new renewable, with especially an significant increase of wind power. And so there is a strong interest to develop further pump storage power plant to better integrate these new renewable energies. But then, once you decide to integrate a new pump storage power plant, you have many different technologies available. If we look at the different possibilities, if we look at the hydraulic machine first, you may have reversible units with Francis pump turbines, or multi-stage pump turbines, or Derya pump turbines. You may have ternary units with pump, motor, generator, plus turbines. Or what is a bit new, not in Japan, because in Japan they use it since more than 30 years, but we may use now a new technology, namely variable speed units, either based on doubly fed induction machine, DFIM, or synchronous machine with full-size frequency converter, FSFC. So if I have a short look at the different technology, if we use reversible Francis pump turbines, this is a typical example, we can have multi-stage Francis pump turbines. Here it's like four stages, the example of usine of Bissort. Or there is also some two stages regulated pump turbines. Here, the point is there are two distributors, one for each of the stage, so that you can control the power in turbine mode. While here, you have like four or five stages, and you don't have any distributor. So in turbine mode, for example, you cannot drive the power. You cannot change the power. It's on or off. And for low head, you may use Derya pump turbines with movable blades. If I go to the advantages or disadvantages of these different technologies. If we look at single-stage Francis pump turbines, one of the big advantages is you have just one unit that does the two jobs. It pumps and it turbines. So it's extremely compact. It has a reduced cost because you have just one pump turbine and one motor generator. You can control the power in turbine mode with the guide vanes. But the transients, as it was said this morning by Professor Avalon, the transients might be very challenging due to the S shape of the pump turbines. So you have to account for a significant water hammer phenomena. In general, you need a large submergence of the unit, minus 40, 50, 60 meters, depends the specific speed, depends the power, and the rotational speed you choose. And you are limited in head, but you can reach up to 700 meters. That's a bit the nowadays state of the art. One example was given this morning with Lynn Lehman, for example. Then, if you want to go for higher head, you don't have so many choice. You need to pile several runners together. So either you go for a multi-stage pump, not without any distributor, so you cannot control the power, as I've said, but you can reach, you have actually no really limits in heads, but the reference is about 1,300 meters. If you want to go further, you put one more stage and you can go one head higher if needed. In general, it has reduced submergence because you need the submergence of one stage and not the submergence of the full head. But the drawback is you have not the possibility to control the power. As I've said, it's on or off. So if you have a unit of 100 megawatts, it's zero or plus 100 megawatts, nothing in between. Then if you use two-stage regulated pump turbine, this is a way to cope with the disadvantage of not controllable power. So if you have two stages, you have access from the top and from below to put distributors. Then it means you are able to control the power in turbine mode and you can go to much higher head. There is one reference from GE, which is Yongyang. It is the one I've shown here. And it goes up to 820 meters. It has also limited submergence because you need the submergence of one stage. Usually it features, as compared to the same machine, let's say in a single stage, you have lower vibration, you have improved stability, smoother transients because you have higher specific speed. But it's more complex for sure, and therefore the cost is higher. Derrière regulated pump turbines, actually it's only applicable to low head. So the head has to be lower than 200 meters. But it has one major advantage. You can control the input power in pump thanks to the blade that you can move. And you can manage large head variations. And also thanks to the blade, movable blades, you have also extended operating range. But again, this is also a bit complex unit because you need to accommodate the blade as it is for Kaplan. And you have a higher cost. Then if you go to single stage reversible pump turbines, I think you are familiar with all these operating modes of the pump turbine. We saw this morning that positive rotational speed, positive discharge leads to the turbine operation. So if you want to rotate in pump mode, you need negative rotational speed and then you will get negative discharge. And then there is this runaway curve by on which you find the turbine brake and the reverse pump. Why I'm mentioning about this, it is because of this S shape of the characteristic of the pump turbine. Depending on the slope of the characteristics, this is the torque characteristic, this is the discharge characteristic. So for the point for which the torque, zero torque, for which the torque is equal to zero, if we check the slope of the characteristics, if the slope is negative, the pump turbine would be stable. While if the slope of this characteristic is positive, the pump turbine would be unstable, and then it means during the transients you go down to reverse pumping mode. So the pump turbine will not only cut off the discharge, but it will also reverse the discharge to negative values. You will end up into this reverse pumping operation. This is why it's quite challenging. And let's say the lower the specific speed, the more pronounced is this S shape, and the more severe are the hydraulic transients. So this is something you have to keep in mind. Then another technology, possible technology I mentioned before, is ternary units. It's more expensive for sure because you need a motor generator, a turbine, and a pump. And you need a mechanical coupling in between. Here are two different example of application. One is in Austria, it's quite well known, Kopfswerk 2, where they have a challenging arrangement with the Pelton turbine at the top, motor generator in the middle. They have this so-called void torque converter here to link to the multi-stage pump here. Here it's quite ambitious because the motor generator is just below the water, so you need very good seals, but it works. And in this particular case, the Pelton turbine was actually pressurized. Another example is Ongrin-Léman. This is in Switzerland, nearby Lausanne. And similar arrangement, but here the motor generator is at the top. Then there is a Pelton turbine just below. Here is just a mechanical coupling, and the pump is at the bottom for cavitation reasons we have seen before. And this is another example of application. The challenge here is also the rotor dynamics, because, for example, this shaft line's length is about 38 meters between the top and the bottom, so it's a bit challenging. So if we look at the main advantage, you have improved efficiency in turbine in pump mode because you choose separately the turbine and the pump. You do not have to make a compromise as it is the case in single stage pump turbine. You have a very high operational flexibility because the pump and the turbines rotate in the same direction. So you can change quite easily from pump to turbine and in a short time. You have extended operating range, provided you use Peltons, then you have different number of injector to play with. And you have a easy startup. You use the turbine to start the pump. You can do active power control in pumping mode. This is the so-called hydraulic short circuit. I will just explain a bit more about it after. You have normally also smoother transients. To give just some order of magnitudes, for the same project, if you go for reversible pump turbines, very quickly you will end up with plus 30% of overpressure due to water hammer. If you go for a ternary unit for the same project with multi-stage pump and Peltons, the overpressure is about 10%. So you reduce significantly the overpressure, and you can also reduce the thickness of the pipe wall material due to the design pressure. So it has smoother hydraulic transients, efficient condenser mode, but of course you have many machines. You have a motor generator, you have a turbine, you have a pump, you have a mechanical coupler, and you have lots of bearings. So all together this makes the unit quite complex and more expensive. And if we assume that the reliability is proportional to the number of components, maybe you may have some more issues. And you have slightly lower efficiency in pumping mode because in pumping mode, the Pelton turbine is rotating in the air also. So you have to carry the Pelton turbine with you. And you have the ventilation losses. If I come back shortly to the hydraulic short circuits, this is the case in Ongrin-Léman, for example. You have the motor generator in the top. You have the Pelton turbine, the mechanical coupling, and the multi-stage pump. And you can use the hydraulic short circuits when you are in pumping mode. So mostly you are pumping. The unit, the pump is pumping at full power. But then you can adapt the input power by using the turbine. So part of the discharge goes back to the turbine. And of course, there is kind of a recirculating discharge. But the main advantage is so that you can modulate the power, let's say, between almost zero, not exactly zero, to full power, so that you can adapt the input power, which is quite interesting from the power network perspective. Now, you may also decide to combine reversible pump turbines together with variable speed units. So in case you have a pump turbine, you can have fixed speed units with a synchronous motor generator or a variable speed unit. In that case, you may use either, let's say, a synchronous machine with a full power converter, so frequency converter on the synchronous machine side, or you can go for asynchronous machine with doubly fed induction machine using a power frequency converter on the rotor side. The main difference between these two arrangements is the fact that this frequency converter sees the full power of the unit. So 100% of the power of the synchronous machine goes through the frequency converter. In the case of the doubly fed induction machine, the frequency converter only see the slip power. To say something, if you plan to have 10% speed variation, plus minus 10%, then you will need only to transfer 10% of the power through the frequency converter. So in comparison, this frequency converter would be 10 times smaller and 10 times, let's say, cheaper. But we will see that there are also costs to account for the asynchronous machine. But that's the basic idea of the doubly fed induction machine. If we look at the the technology itself, that's the synchronous machine with salient poles, which we are used to. In case of doubly fed induction machine, you have an asynchronous machine with induction machine with slip rings, and you don't have DC current on the rotor, but you have AC current. So you have this electrical arrangement in case of full-size frequency converter with synchronous machine and the frequency converter. And with the doubly fed induction machine, you have this arrangement with the frequency converter only linked to the rotor here. If we look again to advantages and disadvantages of this technology, the variable speed technology in general enables active power control in pumping mode. I will explain a bit more about it afterwards, but if you have fixed water level and fixed rotational speed, basically you have fixed input power in pump, unless you are able to change the speed. So this is the main advantage of the variable speed technology. And also you will see that it has many advantages because then you can control the power with the electrical machines. And by controlling the power with the electrical machines makes it extremely fast to change the active power. So you're able then to do fast active power injection or absorption in pump and turbine mode, thanks to the so-called flywheel effect that has been shown by Professor Avalon.
Comment se dit ça en castellano, flywheel?
Volante de inercia, o volante.
Es mejor flywheel. Disculpe, excuse-moi.
Non, pas de souci. Usually, it allows also extended operating range in turbine and pumping mode, higher efficiency in turbine mode, pump start without additional equipment, it's suitable for, it allows also very large head variations, as we have seen the case of Lindt-Liemann in pumping mode. And you can provide reactive power control even at standstill using the frequency converter. If we look a bit more into the details of advantages and disadvantages between these two technologies, in case of doubly fed induction machine, the advantage is the cost of the frequency converter, which is smaller. It is sized for 10% of the nominal power. The efficiency is a bit higher because the frequency converter is generating losses only on 10% of the power. But it has complex rotor because it's AC rotor. And the rotor dynamics is quite challenging because the distance between the two bearings for the same power, the length of the active zone of the rotor is higher. And then it's more challenging from the rotor dynamics perspective because of increased distance between the two bearings for the same power, of course. But the drawback is you are limited in the speed range you can allow. It's typically plus minus 10%. And it means for startup in pumping mode is a bit challenging because you need to find a way to bring the unit to 90% of the speed. And in general, it means you have to dewater the pump to bring it to 90% and then to rewater. While if you have a full-size frequency converter, the advantage is you can change the speed from 0 to 100% continuously without any gap. So it means you can start a pump directly from the grid, from zero speed to full, or let's say zero speed to full power, using directly the frequency converter. So it allows for fast startup, and because you don't need synchronization with the grid, it's the frequency converter that makes the link in between. And you have very strong torque at the zero speed to start up the pump, for example. And also it means you, and I will show an example just afterwards, you can change from pump to turbine and back to pump without any stop, without any discontinuity. This you cannot do with a doubly fed induction machine because each start in pumping mode, you have to dewater. It takes a bit of time until you can start up the pump. The disadvantage is the size of the frequency converter. It's just the nominal power of the unit, so the cost is quite high. And also, the losses apply to 100% of the power. So if you have, let's say, 1% of efficiency loss in the frequency converter, you lose 1% of the total power of the unit. While here, you would lose 10% of 1%.
Christophe, may I ask you, what is today the rated limit for, reasonable limit for power converter for efficiency?
So I think I have a slide for it afterwards, but the limit is, in the past was about 100 megawatts. There is one which is built in Switzerland, is Grimsel 2, is 100 megawatts. But they tend to say that nowadays up to 150, it's still economically interesting. So the limit in it's more economical question. Technically speaking, it's feasible to go even to 500 MVA if needed, but the restriction is more from the economical perspective.
So it's matter of performance curve.
Yeah, exactly.
The power electronics
cost goes down. Yeah, exactly, and that's the trend. So nowadays the limit, the threshold would be about 150 megawatts. That's a bit the limit, I would say. I will not go too much into the details, but in the old time, for example, there is an example in Germany, which is called Goldisthal. The frequency converter was based on cyclo converter. It's more complex frequency converter, and this absorbs some reactive power. Nowadays, we use more voltage source inverter, where you are fully flexible to inject or absorb a reactive power. And it's more, that is the today technology. Then you may use on the electrical side two level, three level. The two level frequency converter would make the sinusoid of the voltage looks like this. you have to play between positive value of voltage, zero, and a negative value of the voltage. So your sinus is not really much a sinus. It's a quelque chose de haché.
Chopped
shape of the voltage. If you have three levels, you can play between three levels, so it starts to look like a bit more sinusoid.
Which means that you have many harmonics there.
Yeah, this brings the higher the number of level of voltage, the lower the harmonics, let's say. But in any case, you will get some harmonics on the grid. Just interesting fact, so if we looked at the motor generator operating range, it has some limitations from the motor generator side. Interesting, from the doubly filled induction machine, you are not allowed to operate at the nominal speed. This is a forbidden range, because in this case, you would have DC current through the T-resistors, and the T-resistors are not designed for it. But it's interesting. So you have to switch from some RPM from the nominal value. You cannot operate exactly at the nominal value of the rotational speed.
Yeah, because for a double-fed machine, synchronous mesh is zero torque. So something is singular.
Yeah, and you have no sleep anymore, so the current will be continuous through the semiconductors, and the semiconductors are not designed
for... Those electrical engineers have some challenge, huh?
Yeah.
It's good.
Fortunately.
They need to have some.
And if I look at Switzerland, about some project we have ongoing or under study about pump storage power plant. In green are the pump storage power plants that already exist. In orange, these are three pump storage power plants that are recently commissioned, actually. Lindlimern has been commissioned in 2017. Hongrin-Léman has been commissioned in 2016. And Nandedrens is still under commissioning, let's say. And there are some others, potential projects. This project, Nandedrens, is 900 megawatt. Lindlimern is 1 gigawatt. Lago Bianco would be 1 gigawatt. This would be about 600 megawatt, for example. So that was the forecast in 2011. Unfortunately, the others project stopped because the price of electricity went down. But still, the project exists. And when the electricity market will rise again, very likely this project will restart. Just some example of applications. The example of Lintal that has been shown already this morning with reversible pump turbines with a head range between 560 up to 700 meters head, 250 megawatts, and typically with 500 RPM, this makes this pump turbine of very low specific speed. So here the hydraulic transients are extremely challenging. The speed range typically plus minus 6%. So here is the slide for you, François, is the evolution of the cost versus the power of the unit. So the cost of the full size frequency converter, the limit, the threshold was about 100 megawatts, let's say 8 years ago. And one example of application of full-size frequency converter is Grimsel 2 in Switzerland, where there are four units, each is 100 megawatts. And on one of the units, they put one frequency converter so that they get a high flexibility on one of the units. Nowadays, this limit would be moved towards 150 megawatts. As I've mentioned before, if you go for a single stage reversible pump turbines with fixed speed, normally a pump turbine first is a pump. You have to design a pump because the flow is decelerating, so it's a divergent through the runner. So it's more prone to a flow separation and so on. So you have to design a pump. And then you adapt a bit the shape of the blade so that in turbine direction is also quite good. But the fact that you design first a pump and you target the operating point in pumping mode, the drawback is your best efficiency point of the turbine is completely out of the operating range of your unit. This is, by design, this cannot be other way around. Unfortunately, you cannot match, you can only match in pump, but you cannot match in turbine. So in, as it was said this morning, between mom and dad, it works well in pump, but doesn't work so much in turbine operation. And so this is why you have lower efficiency with a pump turbine when it's operated in turbine mode, because the normal head range is by far below the best efficiency point. But the beauty of the variable speed is by changing the speed, you can bring down this best efficiency point closer to your operating range. And then if you change the speed, this best efficiency point will move down around here, let's say. So you manage to have at least the best efficiency point somewhere in your operating range, usually at the highest head. You can reach it only for the highest head. But it means you have a huge gain in efficiency on the all over the all operating range of the turbine. So basically, if I look in turbine mode, with fixed speed, you would have, for a given head, this efficiency curve. If you are in variable speed, depending the for each speed, you have a different efficiency hill curve. And of course, then you use the, let's say, envelope, as you would do in Kaplan turbine. And on most of the operating range, you have much higher efficiency. Only at full power and the highest head, you have the same efficiency, I would say. In pumping mode, we have seen a bit the limit of operation also this morning. You are restricted by the maximum head, minimum head. But normally, if you have fixed speed, you have, for a given head, you have just one operating point, and that's it. While if you can change the speed, you have all this operating range that is possible, restricted between the maximum head, the minimum head, the stability limit of the pump with the hump zone here, the power limit, and some cavitation limits also here. Here is just an example with some numbers. Before was just some illustration, but it's just good to see some real numbers. It's the case of Goldisthal in Germany. And this unit is 270 megawatts. It's two parallel units. At that time, they only choose to they had four units. Two are fixed speed and two are variable speed. They were not sure. It was a bit too risky at that time to go directly for four units with variable speed. They were unsure about the technology. It's back into the year 2004. But the owner said if they would have to rebuild it from scratch, nowadays they would go for four variable speed units when they have seen the advantages of having variable speed units. But at that time, it was a bit risky. And here is just the operating range and efficiency curve, for example, you have in turbine mode. So in fixed speed, that's the efficiency curve they got. And in red is the efficiency curve you reach with the fixed speed. So most of the time, you operate at the minimum speed to lower the efficiency, best efficiency point down to your operating range. And only for the highest power, you increase a bit the speed. For pumping mode, you can see here the extended operating range as compared to a fixed speed characteristic, then you get all this range. So that's the main advantage of the variable speed unit, is you can change the power from, let's say, about 50% up to 100%, or almost sure is 60% to 100%. Then it depends, mom and dad, how they are made, if it fits or more or less good. That's a control strategy of variable speed unit. Then, of course, you have a motor generator to control, a turbine to control, and you have one more degree of freedom, which is the rotational speed. So it makes the control a bit more complicated, but also more flexible. But I will come back to the control strategy. So that's the control strategy in pump mode. And as I've said, in turbine mode, for a given head, And a given rotational speed, it means you operate at given N11. To change the power, you can open the guide vanes. This will change the discharge, and this will change the torque. If you do the same in pumping mode, for a given head and a given speed, you have a given N11. And actually, all the pump characteristic curve merge into only a single pump curve. So you cannot change the power. You can do whatever you want with your blades. You will only reduce the efficiency with the guide vanes. You cannot change the input power. If you want to change the input power, the only solution is to change the rotational speed. If you increase the rotational speed, you have more power. If you reduce the rotational speed, you have less power. This is the main motivation of having variable speed unit, at least from the grid perspective. Here is just an example of application for Grimsel 2 power plant. And by changing the speed between ±7%, you can change the input power in pump ±20%. So it means you can change the power between 60% and 100% of the nominal power of the unit. So it's quite interesting from the power network perspective. To compare all this technology between them, especially with respect to dynamic performances, it's good to use simulation in general. And at EPFL, we have developed a Simpson simulation software to model hydroelectric power plant, let's say from water to wire, including the waterways, the electrical installation, rotating inertia, and also the control system. So that we can model the pump storage power plant and model the different technology and compare how each technology performs. And then we can have a fair comparison. In this simulation software, we have...
I would like to ask something before going that far about this speed control. It's quite challenging for me because I'm mechanical, more hydraulic. So is the technology that you have beside your generator something that you can install and connect, or it's something inherent to the machine? I mean, if you have an old CTMOS machine and you add something just to make it variable, as you made for a little pump, or is
Then I would say definitely it's better to go for a full-size frequency converter, because then it's kind of out of the shelf. So you buy it, you install it, you have some control functionalities, and the control is included in the frequency converter. And then it's, as you said, the control is embedded into the frequency converter. Then you still have your turbine governor, the same as you have before. You have probably to change the way you drive your turbine. But then you have two turbine governor and the frequency converter, and then you just have to give the right set point to each of them. And then it's, I would say, rather easy conversion to a variable speed. If you go to doubly fed induction machine, then it's much more complicated because the induction machine, the control of the induction machines is rather complex, so you have to integrate. Of course, there are some functionality in the frequency converter, but even though, you have to understand how to control the asynchronous machine itself, which is not so easy, in active-reactive power, and together with the turbine, and taking into consideration that you have one more degree of freedom, which is the rotational speed. So I would say doubly fed induction machine is very complex, and usually that's the supplier who does the overall control, and he developed the control for the overall unit because it's quite complex. If you go for full-size frequency converter, it's somehow easier because you can rely on the frequency converter functionalities, because then the full power goes through it. And then you have to play with the set point you give directly to the frequency converter, and you use your turbine in parallel. So then you just have to take care that you give the right set point to each of the component, the frequency converter and the turbine. For doubly fed induction machine, you need to have the overall picture, and because you need to control everything as a whole. You cannot split anymore. It's much more complicated, I would say.
But you need a room for the power electronics, because it's quite, for 100 megawatt, what is the size?
This room is small. it's bigger than this room.
Because he has an efficiency, which means if he has his feature inefficiency, he has losses to cool it. So 2% of 100 megawatt is 2 megawatt. Cool.
Yeah. This is also why it's more suitable for lower power, I would say, and for higher power, for efficiency reason, for overall operational functionalities, it's better to go for a doubly fed induction machine. Nowadays, as I've said, above 150 megawatts, everyone would go for a doubly fed induction machine, even so it's more complex. But maybe you have.
Allow me an additional comment. Christopher is talking now about the advantage in pump turbines, which is advantage in one side and the other side. When we are talking just about the turbine, we have to study what is the real advantage, because the advantage of the variable speed is just when you have a very big variation of head. If you do not have big variation of head, it has no sense to have a variable speeds. And then this is an important additional cost, and we have to take into account what is the advantage. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
And one more question, Christoph. Professor Avelan told us this morning that there are at least 4 power plants working with this technology. And what technology exactly do they use?
For all of them is doubly fed induction machine. So Lindt-Lehmann is doubly fed induction machine. Nandedrans is doubly fed induction machine. Frades 2 is doubly fed induction machine. These are the rated capacity is 160 megawatts. They said if they would have to do it today, they would go for full-size frequency converter, but at that time was beyond the limit. Lindt-Lehmann is 250 megawatts. For sure it would be doubly fed induction machine, and Frades 2 is even much bigger. It's about 400 megawatts, 400 MVA at least. And then there is the unit in Slovenia, which is a doubly fed induction machine as well, and Goldisthal in Germany, I mentioned, which is also doubly fed induction machine. The only large-scale example is this example of Grimsel 2, where they have installed one converter. The good idea behind was to say, okay, we use one converter, but we can drive 4 different units. So they can play with the units they want to link to the frequency converter. Already one converter brings some flexibility to the power plant.
The drivers is the power electronics. And so ABB in this case, Siemens and Mitsubishi are pushing. But this is, as long as we don't decrease, as it was the case for the windmills with the permanent magnet machines, or for the solar, or the PV cells, which the price, the cost has stepped down. We need to work there. So we need that. We have the first investment in order that we can start up the system to decrease and to go along the performance curve. For the moment, if you look at Fradesh, or you take 10% of 400 megawatt, and so it's 40 megawatt, this is payable.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah. The ratio is really what you have, that you can buy from the ABB. And the supplier doesn't fight so much because it's not their supply, it's the supply of ABB. So there is many very market issue there, which is included in the performance curve.
And
mm-hmm.
the trend, Mr. Aguirre told us that perhaps now this is a technology suitable maybe for pump turbine, but for the future, it would be a good idea to have it installed in every power plant. because, for instance, if you have a Francis and you have a speed control, so you can control as well the barter slope and other kind of issues and take more profit of your water at the end.
Mm-hmm.
Would it be a trend or not really? It's not a
yeah, I think it's a bit new, the idea to use a frequency converter on a conventional turbine. In the past, it was only used for pump storage because you can accommodate head variations. That was the first incentive to go for variable speed. Otherwise, the project were not feasible because the head range was too high. So they had to go for it. But then, since they started to apply it, they discovered, oh, we have flywheel. Oh, we can do some reactive power regulation. Oh, we can inject, you will see some example, power in less than 1 second, like 20% variation. Then they discover all the advantages. So I think from the grid stability perspective, it would make sense to have a frequency converter on a turbine, but you need the business case behind to justify the investment.
I think the crucial is the head change, the range of we could address that for Pelton.
Yeah, for Pelton, Pelton makes a lot of sense.
Pelton is driven to run one given head. Otherwise, and so maybe in that case, the variable speed could help.
Mm-hmm.
But on the other hand, the Pelton is a good flexible machine because you can split the discharge by 5 or 6 if you have 6 injectors, 6 nozzles, which means that this will add more on the flexibility by having this
mm-hmm.
to accommodate large range of head. Really, variable speed is for air, as you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
In my presentation on Thursday, I will do an advertisement. I will talk in a practical case of small hydro machines with variable speed, how the hydraulic parameters behave.
Mm-hmm.
For pumps, is obvious, because a pump is an on-off system. A constant speed, a pump is designed for a given discharge. You can play around, but is good for one operating range, 1 point. And then variable speed is valuable for pumps. That's why in the heating systems everywhere, everything was replaced by variable speed, it should be a must. For turbine, we are able to control, we have the guidance, we have the pitch for the Kaplan. And so then the value is when you have head change. And for that reason, this is the case for Pelton. But for the moment, it was not. But it could be. But as Christophe said, it would be business case.
Mm-hmm.
It's why I'm speaking so loudly about the experience curve. We need to have this technology. We are ready. We have many technologies that we can integrate in our power plant. This would be the future of hydropower.
And, yeah?
I have a question. We have a study in navigation dam that works with almost constant flow rate, but with a head that is
changing a lot
during the navigation period.
Yeah.
That would be a good case to install a filter.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. As Professor Arnon was saying, when you have big head variations, is where you can take quite much advantage of frequency converter. Maybe. We have to think about maybe it could replace to some extent the guide vanes, or it could help at least to adapt better the operation condition of the unit according to the head, for sure. Yeah, and maybe one another topic where the frequency converter could help in turbine is for the startup. Nowadays, the startup of the turbines are quite dynamic, quite challenging. And sometimes you have some frequency, natural frequency somewhere during the startup. And it's quite challenging for the unit. It's a bit washing machine flow through the turbine during the startup. And if you have frequency converter, you may have a much smoother startup and much faster, actually. Because if you use the converter together with the guide vanes, you don't need to synchronize. So a normal Francis turbine, you need maybe 1 minute to reach nominal speed, and then you start to synchronize. But with frequency converter, you can open the guide vanes from 0 to 100% and go direct to full power. You are all the time synchronized, actually. You don't need to synchronize anymore. So you can go from 0 power to full power It has to be demonstrated still, but very likely 20 seconds, 30 seconds is the order of magnitude, zero to full power.
You cannot stay so long in a speed neural condition. And speed neural condition is the place I show you where you have a very vibration, and so this is a dynamic loading of your structure, and then you experience fatigue. And so if you need to start up very often, by having this component, this will help, because in that case, you not stay so long on the speed neural condition.
And maybe one topic where it could be very interesting is spinning reserve. Nowadays, if you have a unit in spinning reserve, you have to make it rotating, you have to cool it some ways. Here, with a frequency converter, you can provide same services, but the unit is at standstill, because you use just a converter to provide the reactive control, and in case you need the power, you start your unit. But you don't make it running in air for nothing. And you don't have this feeling of water also, which is a bit challenging when you fill the turbine with water. So I think we have to rethink about how to take advantage of this new technology and to apply it to a large hydro. And I think it offers many possibilities. And as I've said, for pump turbines, it started because of the head, but then they found out all the advantages. And I think we are a bit at the beginning of this process to really learn what we can do more with this technology. Even with Frades 2, you will maybe comment on this. The final client didn't realize that he could do much more than just input power adaptation. So he just ordered the basic functionalities, but he did not order for the whole functionality. I will show some example later on. To take most advantage of the frequency converter. The same in Grimsel. It's for sure Grimsel, they just wanted to adapt the power. They didn't realize at that time that they can do a smooth startup in turbine, many other things. And this was not taken into consideration. And I think we have to rethink the way to use the to combine frequency converter together with hydraulic turbines. But I will come back to the control, at least the typical behavior.
I will switch to Spanish just to ask Carlos. Si yo como cliente voy a Void y pido una máquina con control de velocidad, ustedes desarrollan entonces todo, la turbina, el generador y toda la parte electrónica.
Lo que pasa es que otra vez, ¿no? lo que he dicho antes. Hay que ver la justificación instalar el CRM. Sorry for the...
No, está bien. Hablemos también, charlando también.
No nos olvidemos que el punto... If you don't mind, I prefer to speak English. Don't forget that we have the hill diagram, the top of the efficiency, that if we have HQ, move more or less in the maximum gate opening direction. The heat diagram, when you move the velocity, move more or less in the direction of the full opening, or the same gate opening. It means, if you go to lower flow, you do not increase so much the efficiency. But you increase when you move down to lower head. And then the really advantage of the head of the velocity variation is up and down with the head, not with the flow, because with the velocity variation, we do not change the flow efficiency.
Yeah, if the point to design a turbine, you're okay, you select the specific speed, fine, and then you need to size to define the size. And this is defined by head, because head, you have your relationship with the peripheral velocity for a given head, and then it gives you the diameter. And so now the diameter is fixed. But then you change the head. And so how to proceed with that is variable speed. So it's really it's magic. And maybe because Francisco es muy interesante con las vibraciones, eso es una mala noticia para ti, porque con la velocidad variable se disminuyen las vibraciones.
Yeah, that's right.
Era un chiste.
If you find a resonance, you just have to change the speed. Most of the time, it will work. So you. So I will try to show some example of control capability of variable speed, because I think it's quite interesting also. So I was just introducing the Simpson software. So you have many electrical machines, synchronous, asynchronous, DC, permanent magnet, and you can combine with three phases element and converter. And in hydraulic system, you have many components like pipes, surge tanks, all types of turbine, Francis, Pelton, Kaplan, pumps, propellers, and all types of surge tanks. And of course, we have validated the software. From the hydraulic side, I will just show some examples of validation. So here is just a case of pump storage power plant in US, 4x400 megawatts. And on the left-hand side, this is turbine mode. In the right-hand side, this is pumping mode. So that's the layout with four units in parallel, and there is a downstream surge tank here. And it is emergency shutdown in turbine, and this is water level evolution in the surge tank, pressure in the draft tube, pressure in the spiral case, and in black is measurements, and in red is a simulation. So overall, you can see that it fits rather well. Another example in electrical application. Here is very complex drive for double winding synchronous machine of ABB. It's a 20 megawatt air compressor. So there is two windings. The simulation is the light curve. The thick curve is the measurements, or vice versa, I don't know. But that's the winding number one on the left. That's winding number two on the bottom here. And you see that you kind of distinguish between measurements and simulation almost. So now that I've shown that somehow when you have the right data, it simulates correct properly, we'll show some example of application in the field of variable speed unit. First example is a double fan induction machine. So here is a power plant with a 230 megawatts pump turbine. Which is connected, which is driven by a double fan induction machine. And in terms of control, so here you have to decide whether who is driving the power, because either the turbine or the motor generator can control the power. The normal approach is that the generator controls the power and the turbine controls the speed. That's the normal approach. Then, of course, you need to define what is the optimal rotational speed according to the operating head and the specified operating point. So you have a lookup table that tells you what is the optimal speed for your new operating conditions. And using this control approach, it means the output power, there is a zoom here. The set point is in red, and in blue, this is the response of the motor generator. Because the time constant of the response is an electrical time constant, which is extremely short. So the response time is about 0.3 seconds to change 20% of the power. So let's say it's instantaneous from the electrical side. This is possible thanks to the flywheel effect, because of course this excess of energy has to go somewhere. And this excess of energy actually is accelerating the rotational speed of the unit. So the unit itself, its rotational speed increases because it's storing the difference of 20% power that you have instantaneously reduced. And this represents the difference of kinetic energy over time. But during this time, the turbine identifies that the speed increases, so it will control the speed, so the guide vane closes, and it controls the speed and brings back the speed to the new target value or nominal value. So the good thing is here you have plenty of time on the turbine side to control the speed and bring it back to the nominal value during the time that you have made a very fast change in active power on the motor generator side, thanks to the fact that you have this flywheel effect. And in pumping mode, usually we use the same approach. The active power is controlled also by the motor generator, but actually in pumping mode, you do not control very much, as I've said, once the water level and the rotational speed is fixed, the power is fixed. So you only adapt the power, and indirectly the speed adapts itself to the new input power. But the only thing you do is you just adapt the guidelines to have always the maximum best efficiency, just to make sure that according to your head and rotational speed, you have the best efficiency point. And but you can achieve the same power performance. It means you can change the power to about 20% in 0.3 seconds. And again, you have this flywheel effect. But here, you don't need really to control the speed, because the speed is inherently controlled by the pump power, let's say. It's driven by the pump power. So that was simulation results. And when we got these results of change of power 20% in 0.3 seconds, we started to question ourselves, is it really feasible? And then we compared to a publication of the Japanese. They published for 400 megawatt Okawachi power station, where they made on-site power step set point changes, plus 20%, minus 20%, and as you can see, it's almost instantaneous. The step in power is extremely sharp, and the response in terms of speed is pretty much the same as what we got. So it was confirmed by this publication that this is really feasible to have such a fast power set point changes. Then once we have this technology in hand, you can use it to improve the stability of power network. Here we intentionally have taken a small power network so that the contribution of the pump storage is much higher. So here we have one hydro power plant, plus minus 250 megawatts. One thermal power plant, 1 gigawatt, 1.3 gigawatts, and one wind power of 200 megawatts that are all connected to the same consumer load. And the idea is here to see how this pump storage power plant can balance the wind power variation. So we could either use a ternary unit with fixed speed or use a variable speed unit. And we have compared the response of the two different technology. And that's the model of the thermal power plant. That's the model of the wind turbine. So of course, we assume that there was 100 wind turbines, but we have not modeled the 100 of them. We used an aggregated model, let's say, of an equivalent wind turbine. And that's the final model we have with the variable speed configuration. And we checked we perform simulation of load rejection in turbine mode, load acceptance in pumping mode, and input power variation in pumping mode. So that's the variable speed unit, that's the windmill, and that's the thermal power plant, and that's the consumer load. And here we compare simulation result between fixed speed in blue and variable speed in red, in case of load rejection in turbine mode. So we made a step change in the consumption of the consumer load. And the frequency deviation is divided by a factor of 10 by having a variable speed unit, because you can react extremely fast. Then from voltage perspective, it makes no difference, except the fact that you have harmonics. So the voltage is not anymore a flat curve. You have some harmonics because of the converter. The same in case of operation in pumping mode. You can also, as you can change the power extremely fast in pumping mode also, you can also accommodate, reduce the frequency deviation by order of factor 10 in case of load variation, load increase in pumping mode. And here we have just simulated some wind variations, a bit kind of random. And again, we have similar results. Frequency deviation are reduced by a factor of 10 about. A third example comes from the Hyperbole project. Professor Vallon mentioned this morning. It was a consortium project led by the EPFL, were involved G, Andritz, and Voigt, of course, also our small company, and together with Academia, with HES Valle, Inestec in Porto, UPC in Catalonia, and University of Stuttgart. And in this case, we had two test cases. One was dedicated to Francis turbine, and another one was dedicated to pump turbine. And the idea was to see how much we can take advantage of full-size frequency converter to change from turbine to pumping mode without any stop in between. If you have doubly fed induction machine, to go from turbine to pump, you need to stop because you need to dewater the pump. In case you have full-size frequency converter, you can go directly from turbine down to pump and vice versa, of course. And that's what has been investigated. And the interesting things was we used a reduced scale model that corresponds to an existing prototype for which we have the data of the waterway. It's 2 × 210 megawatts. The head is a rather low head, 133 meter of water column, 200 RPM, and it corresponds to a rather high specific speed, NQ56. And here are the data of the model. So the scale ratio was a factor 16, I think, between the prototype diameter, about 4 meters, and the model diameter was 240 millimeters. And here, interesting was Andrit has done some model testing, and they really performed change from pump to turbine back to pump operation in very short time, as short as 4 seconds. Transition from minus 1,000 RPM to plus 1,000 RPM and back to minus 1,000 RPM. So from pump, turbine, pump. So from the pump turbine characteristics, we have seen the 4 quadrant. We start in pump, we keep constant guide vanes, and we go straight to turbine and then back to pump. So we go through this washing machine quadrant, which is the pump brake, and we will see that it's quite rough operation. So the measurements are the solid line, the dots are the simulation. I would have done it the other way around, but that's the colleague from Andritz, they thought in another way. But it's comparison between simulation and measurements on of the reduced scale model. So they simulated the test rig loop, and they compared simulation with Simpson and measurements. So that's the speed in black. They always have constant guide vane, like mid opening, 15 degree, and they go from pump to turbine and back to pump. That's the head variation, and that's the time evolution in the red of the discharge. So you can see that with 1D model, you can catch the macro behavior of the power plant, of the hydraulic system. And you can very well reproduce the time of evolution of the head, discharge, and all the variables. And here are two movies, and which gives an impression of how it behaves. And hopefully. I think I have to go out. Okay, I don't know why, but I cannot run it when it's full size. So here is the pump turbine. It's first rotating in pump, then it goes to turbine, and back in pump, and in turbine. So that's the noise that we can hear when it goes from pump to turbine, and vice versa. So the switch here is achieved in 8 seconds. And if we have a look to the flow inside the machine, it's quite interesting. First, the flow is in pumping direction. Then it switched to turbine mode. Then we have a little rope here. We are in turbine operations and back to pumping operations. So you can see that it's quite rough. There is cavitation, strong cavitation, and it's back. Here we could see some little cavitations that shows that we are in pumping mode operation. I'll just run it again. So here is pump goes to turbine. In turbine, there is this little rope, and then it will switch back from turbine. And yeah.
The stroboscope there is following the speed. It's not in a constant.
It's following the blade. It's set, it is triggered by the blade position. Okay. It always shoots the same blade, actually. Yeah. And so here the transition was made in 8 seconds. And I will just run once more the other movie. The noise gives an impression what it gives. That's from pump to turbine. This is the normal way to proceed. It goes the same direction as the flow, but from pump to turbine is more challenging. From turbine to pump is more challenging, sorry. This one.
Full open, no closing anything.
Exactly, constant guide vanes. It the guide vanes opening was 50% about, yeah. Something
so
like.
And no main inlet valve movement, nothing.
No, exactly. Yeah, nothing.
And it's
you are getting
expect to happen at the same speed the power plant prototype.
Good question. So this is what we will see now by simulation, because then. Once we had the experience from the model, we had a look what would it represent on the power plant. And maybe just a short remark. Here they changed the switching time was changed 4 seconds, 12 seconds, or 8 seconds. And actually 8 seconds was the most likely possible on the prototype. I will just show why we have selected. Then the 8 seconds transition time was more deeply investigated because it was fitting better the possible changing mode on the prototype side. And interesting also, they instrumented the runner, they put transducer on the pump turbine itself, and strain gauges measurements. And here is the comparison of fast transition. This is a slow transition. And this is the pressure fluctuation in the runner. And this is the pressure fluctuation they recorded in the draft tube. So for the fast transition, it starts from pump here. Then we go through the pump brake. Then we end up in turbine operation. And that then back from turbine through the pump brake down to the pump operation. So clearly, you can see that the pump brake is the region where there are the highest pressure fluctuations. This is really the washing machine operation mode. But interesting was to notice that for fast transition, you don't give the time to the flow to establish a clear structure, let's say, and the flow doesn't have the time to develop the excitation, let's say, or a bit less time. So actually, when the transition was fast, the amplitude of pressure fluctuation was reduced. So the faster the transition, the better for the turbine itself, I would say. In terms of
torque reaction.
We will have a look. That's the other question about the torque. And so we simulated the power plant. So that's the two units in parallel. Actually, it has downstream surge tanks. The two units are linked through the surge tanks, and there is a common terrace. So we assume that one of the units would be converted to full-size frequency converter. And we have used also detailed models. And we just had a look to the time scales. Actually, the scale ratio between prototype and model is a factor 16. And we have to use Froude similitudes to find the time scale ratio between prototype and model. And the time scale ratio is proportional to the square root of the dimensions scale ratio. So it means scale ratio of 16 corresponds to time ratio of 4. So basically a transition of 8 seconds on the model corresponds to 32 seconds on the prototype. And this is, we thought that 4 seconds would have been 16 seconds on the prototype from full pump to full turbine. We had the impression it was short. The simulation have shown that it was too short. And the most feasible transition is about 32 seconds. So we simulated the transition from pump to turbine back to pump. Here also with constant guide vanes. And we have similar behavior of what we have seen on the reduced scale model. Similar head variations. So of course here we do not have the pressure fluctuations inside the machine, but at least we can investigate the impact on the waterway and see, check if it is feasible. And but then of course it's not very much optimal. We had a look at the power, it was a bit too high. So of course here if we check, we have the torque, which is when we go from turbine back to pump, we need much more torque to reverse the flow. And here it needs 1.7 times the torque of the machine, which is by far too high. And also here we exceed the power at some time. So the main problem was here the torque, which was too high on the electrical side. So you had a good good question before. So here we used a simplified model. We compared with a detailed model and we got very good agreement. We were happy. But then, of course, we just started to optimize a bit the sequence because in practice, we would not keep the guide vane constant. For the experiment, the guide vane were kept constant for simplicity to make sure everything is comparable. But of course, for the prototype, we would optimize the sequence as much as we can to minimize pressure fluctuations, water hammer, and everything. So here we just played a bit with the transition time, combined with some guide vane closing and reopening sequence, and we could check the net head, the discharge, but very important was the torque. And too fast transition required too high torque, and that was one of the main limitation for the transition time, and the same for active power. So very important was to check here the electrical quantities, torque, and power. And of course, if we look at the surge tank, it oscillates a lot. Here we haven't investigated all possible solutions, but for sure we would have to pay very much attention to the surge tank also. And yeah, that's it. Here, maybe I will not go too much into the details, but we wanted to compare what would be the difference in terms of performances if instead of a full-size frequency converter, we would have used double-fed induction machine. And we have made some power set point changes, and we had a look to the response using the two different technology. And what we found out that here are the results from doubly fed induction machines. That's the result from full size frequency converter. And we did some step that correspond to 10% of the power, 20% or 40%. That's the active power here, which is negative. Is viewed from the generator side. It's my generator colleagues who likes to have the power negative when you are generating, but that's their own conventions.
Those electrical engines are a bit complicated. And those civil engineers are too much simple. And we are just in the between.
So here we did step of 10%, 20%, or 40%, and back to the nominal power. So again, a step 40%, 20%, or 10%. And if you use doubly fed induction machine, actually, if you have a speed range, let's say plus minus 7%, your speed cannot exceed the 7%. You are not allowed to go beyond. So then it becomes kind of a limitation. And in this particular case, we found out that you need to use a ramp to change the power. The power change could be instantaneous for 10%, but for 20%, you need a ramp of 7 seconds. And if you want to change 40% of the power, you need a ramp of 14 seconds. Otherwise, you go beyond the maximum overspeed. While if you use the full-size frequency converter, you don't mind of the overspeed. You have no limit of overspeed with the full-size frequency converter. So in that case, the power change could be always instantaneous with the full-size frequency converter here. But then when we ramp up back from part load to full load, in that case, the speed reduces. And if the speed drops too low, there is a point above which, with the turbine, you cannot give more power. You reach the maximum torque, and the torque of the generator is too high. So it just brings the unit to zero speed, and somehow it shut down. So you cannot allow infinite power steps. And we found out also some limitation here in the double feed induction machine, but almost the same one with a full-size frequency converter. And we end up with some, we needed to ramp a bit the power set point in 10 or 4 seconds. But these performances depend strongly on the pump turbine characteristics and the waterway. A different pump turbine, different specific speed, different waterway would perform completely different. And we cannot generalize. Here, the only thing we can show is we have different results. That's the only conclusion. Is it says if it's not for sure that you can achieve 40% power steps, this will depend on your waterways and your inertia and on your pump turbine characteristic. And it has to be investigated on case by case basis. Don't want to go too much in details. I think I'm by far over the time, but the colleagues from INESC Porto investigated the case of Portugal. They had the model of the full Portugal, and they investigated the contribution of variable speed power plant, and having only one variable speed unit could significantly improve the frequency deviation in case of a trip of a major load, for example. There are some advanced control we can use also with variable speed to deliver primary, secondary control. And I will not go too much into the details, but we can also add one more power generation source, which is PV cells, to the previous model we have seen. And the critical aspect of the PV, it's even worse than wind power. Wind power change quite high, but in some minutes. Not in some seconds. If you look at here, the power generation on a cloudy day, the power can switch to from 20% to 100% in a couple of seconds. So the PV power is even worse than the wind power that ramp up somehow continuously in some minutes at least. So this is why we had a look to the PV in particular, and we can have the same model with hydro, thermal, wind, and PV, with some models of the PV, and we can see how the hydro can help to reduce the frequency deviation in case. Here we simulated a big cloud going over the PV that reduced by divide by 2 the output power of the PV farm in 5 seconds, and this is a realistic figure, I would say. And without the hydro, the frequency would drop of 200 millihertz. With hydro, conventional control would drop of 160 hertz. And you can restrict the frequency deviation to 80 millihertz in case you use primary and secondary control. Just to show that really the hydro, if you use in the right way the hydro power, you can significantly improve the stability of your power network. So just in conclusion shortly, variable speed, whatever the technology, provide variety of advantages leading to improved flexibility and response time. You have mainly control possibility in pumping mode. extended operating range and improved efficiency and very high dynamic performances. And full-size frequency converter offer new perspective to increase pump storage power plant flexibility due to fast transition from pump to turbine and vice versa. And to evaluate the real performance, you can use 1D simulations. Thank you for your attention.
There is room for other. We can push a bit.
Or we can minimize some.
Have like one or two questions, maybe. Anybody have further questions?
I have one conceptual question. Why do you use fruit similitude instead of rhinos for the?
Actually, we needed a similitude to go back to the times to the time scale, and with the Reynolds. Doesn't make so much sense to you cannot link to the time, and to link to the time we used Froude, but actually Olivier Brown did another way around. He started from the number of rotation you need to go from pump to turbine and vice versa, but you end up to the same rules fortunately. So you just need a similitude rules that enables you to scale the time. And the fruit is well suited. So as I've mentioned, I will just start with an introduction on the software. During this time, you still have time to install the software with the USB key, which is still turning. There is one folder you just have to copy and paste on your computer. It's just executable, and we will launch it together afterwards. But I will just start with an introduction of the software itself, so that you know a bit better what is inside. You might be interested to simulate. There are many reasons for which you might be interested to simulate hydroelectric power plant dynamic behavior, either for transient analysis, for design purposes, to simulate water hammer, short circuits, this kind of extreme events, or for control parameter optimization, to tune the parameter of your turbine governor, or to do a check of stability analysis. We told this morning about vortex rope resonance. This is kind of analysis we can also do with such a 1D simulation models. As I've mentioned, the software allows to model hydroelectric power plant from water to wire, including the waterways, electrical system, rotatic inertia and a control system on both sides, voltage regulator and turbine governor. The software was originally developed on the electrical side by Professor Simon in the EPFL Laboratory of Electrical Machines. Then Professor Avalon started the development of the hydraulic side. And then we founded Power Vision Engineering, who is now dealing with the software, distributing software. And since Professor Simon is retired, there is a new prof in the EPFL in electrical department, Professor Paolone, who is now also involved in some development, new development of the software. The software has a graphical interface. You just put the element, you put the parameters, and then it will generate the equation set with Kirchhoff laws, even for hydraulic system, we will see. And then it uses Runge-Kutta force order for time domain integration. And then you can display simulation results. We have seen the library of electrical elements and the library of hydraulic elements. We also have wind turbine, tidal turbines, PV cells, and so on. Just to mention that the model on the electrical side allows for simulation of short circuit, fault, wrong synchronization. So it's let's say, detailed model of synchronous machine. And there is no simplification of, for example, the derivative of the flux that is often neglected for large-scale simulation software. For software which aims to simulate power network with 5,000 generator, they have to simplify the model. Otherwise, computational time is too high. Here is just the opposite. We would have hard time to simulate 5,000 generator, even though there is no strict limitation, but just the fact that you would have to put by hand 5,000 generators and put by hand the parameters, which will take ages. And there is no strict limitation, but it's more dedicated to very detailed simulation of one given power plant, maybe interaction with two or three others. We simulated up to 50 generators. It's the maximum we can handle by hand, I would say. But just to give an order of idea. So the idea here is to have very detailed model of a full power plant, let's say, instead of having simplified model of all the power plant of the South America. Of course, my colleagues have validated.
Way, for a regional area, it would be okay.
Yeah.
If
yeah.
Some power plant all together, it would be okay to simulate.
And it's quite common to build an aggregated model. As I've shown for the wind turbine, you do not simulate the 200 turbines. You put just one equivalent together. And using such aggregated, for example, one generator represents one power plant. If you do like this with 50 generator, it means 50 power plants. It's already a nice area that you can build. And you can build equivalent model of even a power network could be one generator. Have at least equivalent inertia characteristics. So we have some validation on the electrical side. I've shown some before, and that's the second one. I want just to tell some more words about the modeling on the hydraulic side. The modeling of hydraulic system is based on momentum equation and continuity equation. So from the momentum, we just use the pressure forces, friction forces, the gravity forces, the acceleration forces, and we end up with this equation, partial differential equation. Then we do the mass balance on the volume of control. So the difference of mass which goes in and out is the mass which is stored in the volume of control. So what does it mean? It means we account for the compressibility of the flow and for the wall deformation. We do not consider the fluid as incompressible, because at the scale of a penstock, this is not incompressible anymore. You have to account for the compressibility. And so it means we account for propagation effect, and we end up with this equation for continuity. And we use to do some simplification, like we assume a uniform flow in a cross section, a 1D approach. We neglect convective terms, neglect vertical displacement, and instead of using pressure and flow velocity, we prefer to use the piezometric head and discharge, which leads to this equation set. And in this equation set, very important is the wave speed. So this wave speed accounts for the fluid compressibility and for the wall deformation. So all the compressibility is hidden in the wave speed, actually. And so this is really a wave equation that we are solving here, but apply to the flow in pipes. And actually, as the software was originally developed by some electrical colleagues, it was quite natural that we used electrical analogy to model hydraulic systems. So this is the equations we developed for element of pipe. And that's the equation you can develop for propagation in transmission lines, electrical transmission lines. You can see that they are very analog. And so they have the same nature. They are both partial differential equation, hyperbolic equations. And to the piezometric head in hydraulic correspond, of course, the voltage in electricity. And to the current correspond the discharge. So it means if we follow this approach, these terms correspond to the capacitance, hydraulic capacitance, which account for storage effect by compressibility of the flow and deformation of the pipe. We can identify an hydraulic resistance, which account for head losses, and an hydraulic inductance, which account for inertia effect. So it means we can model an element of pipe with such electrical equivalent scheme with two half inductances, two half resistance, and one capacitance. The main advantage for us to have used this electrical analogy was the fact that we use the same formalism as it was used for electrical system. So we could use straightforward Kirchhoff laws to generate our equation set. And then we benefit from the modularity of our electrical colleagues. So at the end, we have only one differential equation set that includes all equations, electrical, mechanical, control, and hydraulic. We do not solve the hydraulic system separately from the electrical system. Even so, the time constants are very different. We have only one set of equations so that we are sure we take into account properly to the interaction of all the elements. The drawback is we solve we integrate dynamic behavior of hydraulic power plant with a very short integration time step that we need for electrical system in case we simulate hydroelectric system. Of course, if we have only a water hammer question, we will not put the generator and all the rest. So we will restrict ourselves to the hydraulic part. And then we can use a higher integration step. So we have seen the element of a pipe is this electrical equivalent scheme. So if we have a full pipe, we just have to discretize it in several elements. And Simpson behind will just put several times together the same basic electrical equivalent scheme in series. We can account for some viscoelastic behavior of the pipe wall material if the pipe is made of PVC or if it is composite. For small hydro, it's quite popular to use more composite pipes. So it means that we have one additional viscoelastic resistance here in series with the capacitance, and this viscoelastic resistance accounts for the pipe wall damping. Or it could also account for the fluid damping over the frequency. A valve characteristic is just a variable resistance, but it means you need to know the head loss characteristic of your valve as function of the opening. Then a surge tank is mostly an hydraulic capacitance. This is a storage capacity. But as there is a head losses at the inlet, we have to account for the singular head losses with an hydraulic resistance here, which usually depends on the flow direction, depending if it flows in or out of the surge tank. If the surge tank has a rather small cross-section area, actually it means that the inertia effects inside the surge tank are quite important. And the inertia of the flow is a length of the pipe divided by J times the cross-section area. So if this cross-section area becomes small, this inertia effect becomes high. So you cannot neglect anymore the inertia of the water inside the surge tank. So from the modeling point of view, means we have to put one more inductance here in series with the resistance and the capacitance to account for this inertia effect. And it means it's nonlinear terms because it will depend on the water level. So it will change over the according to the water level change. We can model some air vessel. In such a case, the gas behavior is modeled with a simplified model. PV power N is constant. So it's one more capacitance that depends on the volume of the gas, the pressure of the gas, and the type of transformation of the gas. We can model some cavitation. Here, this is not, let's say, water column separation model. This is more the model of a vortex rope below a Francis turbine. This is a cavitation which is at a given place that will not move along the waterways. It will stay at the same place, typically in the draft tube of the turbine, where we account for cavitation compliance and cavitation mass flow gain factor. These two parameters that allows, for example, to model the full load operation or also the part load if we add pressure source fluctuations. Then to model the hydraulic machines, we need to know the characteristics of the machine in terms of N11, Q11, and T11. Here is an example of pump turbine characteristics with the four quadrant. We use the positive turbine convention. So positive speed, positive discharge is the turbine quadrant. Negative rotational speed, negative discharge is the pump quadrant. And here's the guide vane as a parameter. So basically, from the electrical perspective, a turbine would be a pressure source which is driven by the Q11 versus N11 characteristics. So if we know the guide vane, the discharge, and the speed, we can deduce the head of the machine. And from the torque characteristic, if we know the guide vane, the discharge, and the speed, we can derive the torque. And as Professor Avalan showed this morning, we can link the torque of the turbine to the momentum in rotation with the total inertia in rotation, and we can compute the time evolution of the rotational speed of the unit, depending on the torque of the turbine, the electrical machines, and so on. Just for you to know, it's a numerical trick, but we use the so-called Suter polar representation. In case we have a pump turbine, here is a S shape, and it means for the same N11, we have three different Q11. This has a physical meaning because the pump turbine is really unstable, and when you go through this S shape, it's three different flow configuration for the same N11. From the numerical perspective, it's a bit a headache because we have to choose between these three points, and it may lead to some numerical error. If we use polar representation, these three points are viewed from three different theta angles. So if we do a polar transformation, we do not have any more any issue in the S shape. This is what we do inside Simpson, but this is just for you to know that we handle properly the S shape of the pump turbines. Then when we want to model Pelton turbines, we have the injector characteristics and the torque related to one injector. Then if we have several injectors, each injector is modeled individually. From the simulation perspective, we just do the equivalent resistance as we would do in electricity. But to compute the torque, total torque of the Pelton turbine, we sum the contribution of torque of each injector, because each injector may have a different opening. Then if we use deflectors, there are many different types of deflectors. Some are cutting the jet, some are deviating the jet, so it's not possible to have a general definition. So we use what we have called deflection coefficient, which is the ratio between the discharge that really goes to the runner and contributes to the torque, divided by the discharge that leave out the injector. So let's say if this deflection coefficient is equal to 1, it means all the flow goes to the runner and contributes to torque. And if this deflection coefficient is equal to 0, all the flow is deviated and does not contribute anymore to the torque. So actually, we do not compute the torque according to the real opening, but to an equivalent opening which depends on this deflection coefficient. If we have a Kaplan turbine for constant blade angle, we have a turbine characteristic four quadrant, Q11 versus N11 and T11 versus N11. But then for each blade angle, we need one more characteristics. So it means we have to handle family of characteristics, maybe 8 different blade angles for a given project. And then we interpolate just linearly between two blade angles. So that's the library we have. Some examples of validation, I've shown this before. Validation in case of pump storage. Here is an example of Francis turbines. It's four Francis turbines, altogether 75 megawatts. The particular aspect of this power plant is the fact that three of the turbines have, let's call it pressure relief valve. So in case there is an emergency shutdown, the distributor closes extremely fast in 2-3 seconds. And in the same time, there is this pressure relief valve, which is linked hydromechanically to the distributor, and which opens in 2-3 seconds also. So that the guide vanes are closed, so we restrict the overspeed. Here is the overspeed of the unit, which is pretty low. And then we have plenty of time to close the pressure relief valve to mitigate the water hammer. So usually when you have a small unit with extremely small inertia, it's very hard to avoid very high overspeed. And one way to avoid very high overspeed is to use this pressure relief valve, and which mitigates also the water hammer at the same time. But it has to work. If it fails, you broke the penstock and everything. But it's a solution. So here we have comparison with the overspeed here, the pressure at the inlet of the unit. So it fits also quite well. And last example, which deals with Pelton turbines, is the case of Cluson-Dixence, 3 × 423 megawatts. And this was the emergency shutdown of the recommissioning that has been done in 2009. And that's the closure of the injectors. That's the pressure at the bottom of the penstock. And measurements are in blue and simulation in red. So you can see that we predicted quite accurately the maximum pressure, and that's the water level in the surge tank over time. So,
yeah.
Why we don't have the same amplitude later on?
Yeah, in our simulation here, we have applied the same closing time to all the injectors, all of the three units. So in our simulation, 15 injectors have closed simultaneously. In reality, you can see here, actually, all injectors close in a different time.
Hopefully.
And it ranges within 10 seconds, more or less, which makes the closing not fully instantaneous as it is in our simulation. So in our simulation, all close at the same time, and we have this residual water hammer very pronounced, while it is kind of distributed, or there is kind of diffusion thanks to the different closing time. And the water hammer afterwards is lower in the measurements. That's the main reason for this difference. Here are some new development. Some I've mentioned before, but we have introduced also open channel flow, some inclined surge shaft with inflow from the top, some water coolant separation, some differential surge tank, circular open channel draft tube models, some IEEE excitation air valve, pressurized flow transition to free surface flow, and so on. And we have also developed a frequency analysis tool to compute eigenfrequencies and eigenmodes of the hydraulic system. And since 2015, we have brand new graphical user interface. So this is what we'll be using very soon. And just for you to know, we have some others project to continue some development. This was founded by Swiss Federal Office of Energy, and we developed some new functionality, among them a library of turbine characteristics and the capability to link Simpson with other software. And so we have a library now of frequency analysis tools for eigenvalue calculation, force response, transfer function calculation, library for open channel flow, library for two-phase flow, and including air valves and so on, some scripting capability, variable integration step. And very soon we'll have an empirical Francis and Pelton turbine library. See, something now very good outputs that we'll have from the project I just showed before. That's a laboratory for hydraulic machines that is developing this library of turbine characteristics that will be integrated in Simpson, and with a little tool to derive the layout of the turbine to select, let's say, the rotational speeds based on the specific speed and so on.
May I comment on this?
Yes, sure.
So here is the issue is then when you have the civil engineer of the day which want to do transient simulations, either he will say, let's assume that the turbine is a valve, or he will store characteristic from a manufacturer, or previously the one of the guys of the consulting company who was working for Floyd, for Andritz, or for G, store the characteristics and use it. So based on this, what we did is that we use all the model testing that we had at the lab. We build up a statistics of that. Of course, everything was anonymized in order that we don't know that this excellent turbine was from GE or from Floyd. This is anonymized. And then we build up an empirical interpolation function in order to reproduce the operating range of the turbines. And this is now fed into the SimSat. Such a way that in the future we're going to be able to use the SimSat and say, okay, I'm selected for our preliminary study at the early stage. I'm imagining scheduling such a project, discharge power head. We go to a specific speed. You can play around the number of units, for instance. And according to that, you can hit for having a given yield chart, which would be realistic. Of course, it would not be the final yield chart for the project, but at the early stage for the sizing, the dimensioning of the project, it would be just useful. Mm-hmm. And that would be a contribution of SimSat in this case.
Yeah, it's going to be a very useful tool, I think, because all the time during feasibility phase, we need a characteristic something, and we have to fit something, and depends what you have in your database. And if you don't have something that corresponds to your specific project, you have to squeeze too much your turbine characteristic, and you are not sure anymore what you do, actually. While here, we have a very wide range of specific speed in terms of N11 and Q11 range, which is quite large, and this will be a very big progress in very near future. So it's Francis and Pelton database. Another thing is the fact that we will be able to link Simpson with other software, for instance, was EMTP for power network simulations through co-simulations, but that's also something that will come soon. So that's all what I wanted to say about the software itself. So now the idea is we'll play a bit with the software. For those of you who managed to install the software, we'll actually just go through 5 examples that are ready to be simulated, and we'll just look at the simulation results. And each one represents something. So the first one is a Francis turbine emergency shutdown, just one Francis unit with a penstock and draft tube. And we will just see that we can very easily simulate different closing low to optimize water hammer and overspeed and check the pressure in the draft tube, for instance. I should have updated. This is not a Francis. It's clear. It's a Pelton one. We'll just simulate the emergency shutdown with and without deflector. You will see the difference on the overspeed. The third example. Yes, thank you. I don't know if someone needs the key, wants to install the demo version. Okay. And it's just a loading of one unit, then it's running for a while and emergency shutdown. This is typical load case we have to simulate in case we have a surge tank upstream the turbine, because we have to target the worst moment for emergency shutdown to initiate some oscillation in the surge tank and combine two oscillations together to reach the worst conditions in the surge tank. to reach the maximum water level. And in case it is a pump turbine, we could do the same in pumping mode. We load the pump, and then we have emergency shutdown at the worst moment for the down surge in the surge tank. So this is what we simulate here. And last example, if we have time, we will compare simulation results of isolated grid operation of one Francis turbine if we use simplified hydromechanical model or full hydroelectric model. And you will see that there is quite a difference in terms of stability because of the behavior of the voltage regulator, which makes the stability completely different when you simulate really full hydroelectric as compared to when you simulate just hydraulic system alone. So we will just go through these five test cases. I will just show how to run it. So you can follow at the same time as I will do it. So the idea is you should have copied the Simpson folder here somewhere on your computer. And if you have done so, in this folder you have here some PDF, but you have the software here, and you can go in the folder exe. And in the folder exe, you find out the Simpson software, Simpson.exe. If you double click, you should have Simpson that is running. So just once again, from the folder of Simpson, you go into the folder in the folder exe, and then you double click on Simpson exe. And this will open the demo version. I don't know. It's working for those who try to do it.
Yeah, you have an exam.
So now we will just open one of the models. So we just start with the button right here, open here, and you have to find back in your own computer where is the folder from Simpson. And once you found out your folder Simpson, depends where you put it on your own computer, you go in the folder work, and in work you find out the five different examples ready to be simulated. So you can pick the first one, Francis ESD, and then you have a file which extension name is STM. So here again we are in the folder which is called work, and we took the 01 Francis ESD, which stands for emergency shutdown. And if we open this one, you should have this model that opens. And here is a very simple case, but a typical one. We have a penstock, a Francis turbine, and a draft tube. We have a rotating inertia, which represents the inertia of the generator and together with the inertia of the turbine, which is linked to this turbine here. We have here, let's say, point function that defines the closing law of the guide vanes. And if I just double click, for example, on the Francis turbine here, you can see the parameters of the turbine. So there is rated values. So the rated head is 300 meters, rated discharge 85 cubic meters per second, rated torque, so it's 230 megawatts unit about, and rotational speed is 375. So you have the parameter is in this window, or you have all of them here. Myself, I'm too much used to this one, but the new user preferred this one, but I was too much used to the older representation. And the turbine is modeled by a file, which is just a text file. If I go inside the folder where I have this case example in work, Francis, there is a text file, which is the turbine characteristic file. And it's nothing else than just a Y is the guide vane opening, N11, Q11, and T11 in colons. And you don't have to do it. I will just do it myself. I will just open the represent the turbine characteristics so that you see a bit more what it looks like. You don't have to do it. You can if you want, but with the visual here in the this folder, I can change here the types of the file, and I select text file, and in this case I can select, so I change here to text file and I select the turbine characteristic file, and I can open it. He asks me if I want to process it. Yes. Is the Pelton? No. And here I can represent, for example, all the Q11 value, and that's the four quadrant characteristic that is used for this model here. So that the Q11 as function of N11. And if I go back here to the selection of the curve, I can select the T11, and that's the torque curve. And but now we will just run a simulation together. So here with the green button here on the top, if you launch simulation, he asks you if you want to delete the previous results. Yes. And you can launch the simulation, and at the same time it does the simulation, you can open here visual, and the visual here is just the tool we use to display the simulation results. So you launch the simulation with the green button, and visual, you can open the simulation results. So each element of the model has its own text file of results of simulation. And for example, F-turb1 is the name of this element, which is the turbine one. So if I select the F-turb1, and I open it, here it's the default variable I can display. And you can display on the left-hand side H, which is the head, Q is the discharge, T is the torque, N is the speed, and Y is the guide vane. And if you plot it, you have such a simulation results of the emergency shutdown of the turbine unit, for example. So here in this simulation windows at the end, always press bar space. Do not press save. I will not explain too much, but if you save, it doesn't mean you save your model. It means you save the status of the simulation that you have here at the end of the simulation. So we don't want usually to save it, because we want to keep the initial conditions we had at the beginning. So after simulation, you just press bar space. And so here, typically, we have a unit. You always let 10 seconds without any disturbance. And after 10 seconds, here, we disconnect the turbine from the grid. So what does it mean? Means we have the turbine that is normally linked to the grid. And suddenly, we open the circuit breaker. So we don't have any more electromagnetic torque. But we still have the full torque of the turbine, which accelerate the rotating masses. So the rotational speed of the unit increases in black. But to limit the overspeed, we close the guide vane in pink, which reduce the discharge in blue. And as we reduce the discharge, we reduce the torque in green. So when the torque crosses zero, we get the maximum overspeed. The point here is the Francis turbine, as you may know, when it goes to overspeed, it's reducing the discharge, because we go down in Q11. So by just going to runaway, even though you do not close the guide vanes, you get a water hammer. Just from the fact that you have the centrifugal forces inside the runner that pushes the water out of the runner, and you have a reduction of the flow. So the runner itself already produces a water hammer, but if you want to restrict the overspeed, you need to close quite fast the guide vanes. But if you do so, you increase further the water hammer. So you can either use a two-slope closing law, which target is usually to close fast at the beginning to minimize the overspeed, and then to slow down to mitigate a bit the water hammer. And all the game of this kind of simulation is to try to optimize overpressure and overspeed. So for example here, in this F-point function, you can change the closing law. Here, that's all the points you have here in pink of the closing law. Let's assume, for example, I'll just will remove this change of slope here. So to remove this change of slope, it's quite easy. So here I open this F-point function, and this third line, which corresponds to the change of slope, I will just put it into comments. To put it into comments, I just need to put a semicolon in front of it, or you can delete it if you want. Both works. And now I will just relaunch the simulation. And I will maybe open a new visual. So here, from visual, I open again. And I open the F-turb one, and I select H, Q, T, N, and Y, and I plot it here so that we can compare a bit. So we have the first simulation results here, and the new simulation results. So here we have a straight closing law, which is good for the water hammer, but on the contrary, the overspeed has increased significantly. So then, of course, this kind of optimization depends on your project. You have allowable maximum pressure in the penstock and allowable overspeed. So you can then spend hours to tune the closing law to have the best compromise, the best trade-off between overspeed and overpressure. And one quantity we also look at usually is the minimum pressure just below the runner, so at the inlet of the draft tube. And if we want to check it here, we can open the visual again. And there is the element which is called out 2. This is an output value. And this out 2, here you have all the pressure quantity at the inlet of the draft tube. The most interesting one is for sure the pressure. So if you select the last one, HP is the pressure head, C is the flow velocity, HZ is the piezometric head, and HK is the kinetic head. So you have all this information, but what we are usually interested in is the HP is the pressure at the inlet of the draft tube. And for example, here you can see a drop when we shut down, and you can see that we already have negative value before to initiate the emergency shutdown. This is a typical value we have to compute. And maybe interesting here is to show the difference, because at least for pump turbines, this is a question that comes very often. Because here we have a turbine, which has this shape, more or less. And we model actually the transfer of energy with the turbine element. And the draft tube is modeled with an equivalent pipe. But this equivalent pipe is a straight pipe, so it has an equivalent length and an average, a mean cross-section area. And so in general, you have to look at the cross-section area between the inlet and the outlet, and you calculate an average value, and you use it to simulate the draft tube. But the point you have to pay attention to is the diameter here is much smaller than the average diameter you have here. So if you compute the minimum pressure with the average cross section, you have significant deviation as compared to the pressure you have here, just because of the kinetic energy, which is much higher here, as compared to the kinetic energy in the average cross section. And for example, here, if I just want to illustrate this, I can display the pressure that we compute according to this pipe at the first, at the inlet of the pipe here, with the average cross section, and we will compare with the pressure we have here. Computed, this pressure is computed with the minimum cross section here. So if I open here the pipe Z2, for example, and in pipe Z2, I display the pressure HP1, which is the pressure head at the inlet, and I plot it. Let me check. Caramba. Corate. Maybe I will just compare the HZDT1. Yeah, I just compare the HZ, but it's the same quantity in piezometric head. And here you can see the difference. That's the pressure I compute with the minimum cross-section area here. And that's the pressure we compute with the average cross-section. So the gap, the error you make on the minimum pressure is quite significant. So this kind of details might become extremely important when you are at the limit of the minimum pressure you are allowed to fulfill at the draft tube inlet, for example. So here I just presented HZ because I think it was a reference level difference. So here HZ is the piezometric head at the inlet of the draft tube. So you can see that the difference here is about 3 meters because the average cross section is maybe 2 times the minimum cross-section area just below the runner, for example. So that's just an example of what we can, typical simulation for Francis turbine. So here, when you have the simulation window, you should just press bar space to quit. Now if we jump for the second example, it's just a Pelton turbine. So you can go to the button here, open here, and you can open in work the second example, Pelton. Second example, Pelton, and then you select the STM file and you can open it. So we have a Pelton turbine here connected to a penstock and one inertia. One point function is driving the injector position and one point function is just driving the deflectors. If I have a look to the Pelton turbine data, it's similar to the Francis, except it's specific to the Pelton. You have all injector positions. You again have a turbine characteristic, so I can display the turbine characteristics. So from visual here, if you select here in bottom all the file format, in the bottom here, you can select then the turbine characteristic. And if you select the Simpson YN11, Q11, T11, P-turb, he asks if you want proceed, yes. Is it the Pelton, yes. And then you can select all the files except the one which is Q11. Q11 is the injector characteristic, and all the others are the torque characteristic. And here, if I display, I select from here all the torque, and I display it. So we that's the torque characteristic curve we are using here. So the zero speed is here. Nominal speed is around here, and that's the overspeed, the runaway. And here we have extrapolated to negative values, because sometimes we simulate also a ternary unit. And if the pump reverses, the runner direction goes to negative direction. So for some special simulation, we just extended to negative rotation just to make it running. But here, you can just launch the simulation here from the green button here. Yes, you delete the former results. And at the end of the simulation, you press bar space. Now, you can again open Visual. And from the Visual, if it opens, sorry for me, it takes a while, I don't know why. Sorry, I will just reopen it. I don't know why it was taking ages. Sorry, my computer is doing something, I don't know what, but that's the demo effect, I think. Okay. Sorry, it seems my computer is is a bored. Not responding anymore.
You reboot?
Almost.
Okay, the space bar which is waiting.
Yeah. Sorry, I think I have to reboot my computer. Sorry. seems my computer has hard time. Maybe the jet lag, I don't know.
USB?
Yes. Okay. Seems a bit better. Sorry for that. Okay, I'm back, sorry. So if you manage the simulation, you can select pturb, which is the file of the Pelton turbine, and you open it, and you can display H, Q dot is the total discharge, T, the torque, N, Y1, Y2, Y3, and Y4, and you have the transient behavior of the Pelton turbine during the emergency shutdown. So basically what we have here is more or less the same as for the Francis turbine. So during 10 seconds it's operating at nominal power, let's say, and suddenly we disconnect from the grid. So it means we have overspeed here, and at the same time we close here the injector's position. So we have a turbine with four injectors, which are closed linearly, which produce this water hammer in the penstock. But here, we could see that the torque goes down much faster than we close the injectors. This means that we have activated the deflector to restrict the overspeed of the unit here. So here, the deflector closed down in about 2 seconds, and the overspeed is 20%. Now, if we want to simulate the case where the deflector would not work, this may happen, and we can see what would happen then. So here, if you can open the deflector here, the point function that represents the deflector, and in front of the name here, you can just put a semicolon, dot and comma, a semicolon here, front of the name of the element that drives the deflector. And if you put just a semicolon, it means this block is not considered for the simulation. It's just cancelled. And if I run the simulation again, so at the end of the simulation, you press bar space. And here, I will open a second visual. And you can open again pturb 1, pturb, you can select H, Q dot, T, N, Y1, Y2, Y3, and Y4. So H, Q dot, T, N, Y1, Y2, Y3, and Y4. And now we have the same emergency shutdown, but without activating the deflector. So here you could see quite much the difference in terms of overspeed. So if we do not have the deflector, the overspeed goes to almost 1.8 times the nominal speed. This is typical value we expect for Pelton turbines. So in general, the mechanical time constant of Pelton unit is rather small, 4 or 5 seconds, so you really need to have a deflector activating quite fast to restrict the overspeed. Even here with the deflector activating in 2 seconds, you already have almost 20% of overspeed. So we really need it to restrict the overspeed of the unit. From the water hammer perspective, of course, nothing changed, because it's just the closing time of the injectors that is important.
What is the step of the curve, the grid curve, which is the...
Here, the torque. That's the torque.
Yes, the torque, yes.
Yeah, why it looks like stepwise, this is the water hammer, actually, which influence the curve. Now, it might be also the case, I would have to check, that maybe the shape is a bit... But I think it's more the water hammer, because it looks like very much a period here, which is close to the period of the water hammer.
So is the size of the step, the length of the step is the time
For a pressure wave to go back and forth, very likely.
And then push more water into the injector, and so generate more torque. Okay.
Yeah, I think I think so. Yeah.
It's cool, huh? And cheap.
We share the revenue as well. Soy socio de la compañía. Comió mi caro con él. No. Solamente comida.
And that's all I wanted to show with the Pelton. If we jump with the third case, so you can open here a new case. So we go to work and the example number 3. And if you open this example,
how you close the?
You can just close with the cross here. You
can
minimize.
Just straightforward.
Yeah, but you can open several models in parallel if you want. Love. Brute force.
Yes.
We laughed this morning with your expression.
Bruto como ingeniero de mecánica. Diciéremos a mecanismos que son buenos.
So here is a typical case of a Francis turbine where we have a surge tank, and when we have surge tank, we try to find the load case that leads to the maximum water level, and the load case that goes leads to the minimum water level. So for maximum water level, this is what we have here. We have a unit loading. We wait for a while, and then we have an emergency shutdown at the worst moment for the surge tank. So let's run the simulation and we will have a look to the results. So again, if you launch the simulation here from the green button, you launch simulation, yes. And in the during the simulation, you can pick visual here. And in the visual, you can select the F-Turb 1, which is the Francis turbine. And if you select again the Francis turbine, we select always the same H, Q, T, N, and Y. And if you represent plot H, Q, T, N, and Y from F turb 1, you have here the transient of the unit. So the speed is constant because we are linked to the power network. And we open the guide vanes, so the discharge increases. So we start from speed no load, and we go to full opening. And then we wait for a while, and suddenly we simulate an emergency shutdown where we close the guide vanes with the two-slope closing law. If I zoom here, I have similar emergency shutdown as I had before, but before I have the loading. And so at the end of the simulation, you have this window. You can just press bar space. And here what is interesting is to have a look to the surge tank. So again, you select the visual. And from the visual, you can select the file S-Tank1, which is surge tank 1. And if you open it, you can display on the left-hand side the head and the water level, HC. And on the right-hand side, you can display the discharge Q. And this is what you get. So I will try to maybe superpose these two simulation results so that we can better follow. What's happening? So originally, the unit is operating with a constant flow. And suddenly, we open the guide vane here. So as we open the guide vane, the discharge increase. So the first water comes first from the surge tanks. So the water level of the surge tank goes down. And then it would start to oscillate with a quite slow, quite long period. Quite low frequency. This is typical period of mass oscillations. You can see here the period is about 300 seconds, something like this. So it's typical period for mass oscillation. It's several hundreds of seconds. And of course, there is, you cannot avoid that one emergency shutdown may occur just after you loaded the units. And if you are unlucky, this shutdown would come at the worst moment for the surge tank. And the worst moment for the surge tank, one may think first that it's maybe the moment when the oscillation, the water level reached the maximum. But actually, it's not exactly the worst moment. The worst moment for the surge tank would be the moment where we have the maximum inflow into the surge tank. And then you superpose two waves together, and this brings the water level to the most extreme water level here. So we superpose the first oscillation that comes from the loading plus the emergency shutdown at the worst moment, which is selected here to be at the moment where we have the maximum inflow into the surge tank. And this is the kind of game we play with a surge tank, is we simulate all the worst moments to find what is the worst case and to find what is the maximum water level when you design the surge tank. This is a typical case we have to simulate. If it is normal turbine in terms of minimum water level, we would do just the other way around. We would unload the machines from full power to zero power, wait for a while, and increase the power again at the worst moment, which means would be just the opposite when there's the maximum flow rate down. So because then we superpose again two oscillations, a first oscillation from the unloading, and then the reloading will bring the water level down further. So all these kind of combination we can simulate quite easily and look for the most extreme conditions to properly size, for example, the surge tank and the old waterway. Yeah? This one? S-Tank 1. Yeah, the name is S-Tank 1, and then here it's the head H, HC, which is the water level, and Q is the discharge. The difference between H and HC is actually the surge tank, something like this. And H is the head in the gallery, and HC is the water level. So when you have the flows that goes in, it means actually H here is higher than HC, because you need the discharge to flow in. And the difference here are the head losses, delta HR, of the connection here. Let's say the diaphragm, but it's the connection here. And the size of this diameter is extremely important on the time evolution of the surge tank water level. Here you can see that we have significant difference between the head in red, which is the pressure in the headrest tunnel, and the water level. So it means we have significant head losses. And these head losses help to mitigate the maximum water level. If you contract, if you reduce this diameter, you have less water that goes in. So then you will tell me, so I put the minimum diameter, but if you use the minimum diameter, then you don't have a surge tank anymore. You have only a piezometer, and your water hammer goes straight forward to the gallery. And of course, there is an optimum somewhere. And this is also something we can fairly optimized by the simulation, is the head losses here. Here, I would say the head losses are almost optimal, because the maximum pressure in red corresponds to the maximum water level. If I had too much head losses, the head here would be higher than the level. I can just redo the simulation with too much head losses. So for example, here in the search tank, if I double the loss coefficient here, I have 10, or I multiply it by 3, I put 30. Sorry. So I changed here KD from 10 to 30. And if I re-simulate this, you will see quite much the difference. Okay, so here I multiply by 3. This is like if I divided by 1.5 almost the diameter. This is like if I reduce the diameter here. And here you can see I have increased a lot the head in the headrest tunnel. Of course, it has improved the maximum water level, but at the same time, I increased the head that the headrest tunnel sees. So it means in this case, I transmit much more water hammer to the headrest tunnel. And this is something I don't want. So for example, this would be too high head losses at the inlet of the surge tank. So this is why before it was close to the optimum, because this point was at the same level as this point. It was kind of equilibrium between water level and head. So this is the kind of things we can do also. So if I jump to the fourth example, so if I open the fourth example here in work, and I open the example number 4, is the same case, but it's running in pump. So if I launch the simulation, and here I open the visual again, and I display the F turb 1, and I represent HQ, T, N, and Y. Actually, now I have a unit which is operating in pump. It has negative rotational speed. Originally, the guide vanes are closed. I open the guide vanes linearly. The flow goes into pump direction. And after a while, we have pump emergency shutdown with a big drop in head and overpressure. The rotational speed reduces here. So that's the typical transient of a pump trip. And at the end of the simulation, and in parallel, you can also open the surge tank. So you can, with the visual, open S tank 1. And we can display the same quantity, H, H, C, and Q. And here is just the opposite load case as we had before. Here we want to have the minimum water level in the surge tank. So when we do the loading of the unit, it generates a first oscillation and the water level goes up. And when the discharge is maximum flowing out from the surge tank, then we trigger the shutdown and we have superposition of two oscillations, mass oscillations, and the water level goes to the minimum value here, for example. So here we just do the combination, but in the worst condition for the pumping mode, which is the worst minimum water level. So at the end of the simulation, again, you can press bar space. And I will shortly jump to the last example. So I will close this one. And in the last example, we have in folder 5, isolated grid, there are two models. First is hydromechanical model. If I open this one, I just have Francis turbine, penstock, and rotating inertia with a turbine governor. I can simulate it. And I can press bar space. And if I display again the Francis turbine, H, Q, T, N, and Y, this is operation in isolated grid with a load variation with a turbine speed governor. And here, because the load changed, the speed increased, but the turbine governor changed the guide vane to stabilize the speed of the unit. Here, obviously, with the parameter I have, the turbine is stable. Maybe we can improve the response, which is a bit oscillating, but it's stable, let's say. Now, the point is, if I open the second model here, which is in the next folder, still in folder number 5, but hydroelectric model, so that I have this second model here. So in this model, I have the same hydraulic system, but I have added the generator, transformer, voltage regulator. And here I simulate also the generator. And if I simulate here, and I display again the turbine parameters, H, Q, T, N, and Y, you will see that the stability is quite different, even though I have the same turbine, same operating point, same parameters. So the problem is most of the time the turbine parameters are optimized with these kind of models. And if you tune your turbine governor without considering the electrical side for isolated grid, you may end up in this situation during commissioning, and then you start to change everything. So same parameters, but the stability completely different. Here is stable, and here we are clearly at the limit of stability of the system. And just to show that the answer has to come from the turbine governor side, here from the voltage governor, you cannot tune your parameter to have a better response. The response has to be tuned from the turbine governor side. And just to demonstrate it, here I will press bar space. We can just disable the voltage governor. I will just disable here the voltage governor. And you will see that this is because of the voltage governor that we are actually unstable. Press C. And if I refresh the results from the electrical model here, you will see that now I have something almost stable. So that's really the interaction between, let's say, turbine governor and voltage regulator that leads to this unstable behavior. But in reality, you have to use the voltage governor. You cannot disable it because you want to control your voltage. So the only way to solve the problem is to tune better your turbine governor parameters.
You mean the PID?
Yeah, the PID parameters. So that's just a couple of examples that just show typical simulation we do with the software. The last one is just interesting because it just shows that you can put together hydraulic and electrical system, and it opens the floor for hydroelectric simulation and grid stability analysis. This is not the everyday life. This is not the thing we do every day, but could be useful as well. And they just illustrate a bit the types of simulation you can do with the software. So you have the demo version. It's valid until end of December. You can play with it. And if you want some information, do not hesitate to send emails. You are more than welcome. Welcome.
How much is it, the software? How much the software?
The license cost is 7,500 Swiss francs, which is $7,500, I would say. And then there is $1,500 for support and maintenance every year after the first year, if you want it. It's a single user version with a USB stick as a dongle.
We have a license for students if you want to have several classroom of 20 students all together. We have a special license.
Which is 2,500 for 25 users, I would say.
INPG is in China, and INPG is using.
INPG, in Grenoble.
And this software is used for development by Andritz, Freud, and G. They use it for development.
Other question?
One question. Taking into account the case Carlos showed us this morning about injecting air bubbles in the draft tube to change a little bit the possible to simulate,
or? Yeah, to some extent, yes. It's not an easy task, but we can simulate resonance case at part load operation, for example. But you need to derive some parameter from experiments if you want to be very perfect. So it means you have to identify the cavitation volume from the experiment on the model test. Then you can adapt the wave speed of the into the draft tube so that you replicate the cavitation compliance into the draft tube. Here would be just the parameter will be the wave average wave speed into the draft tube that has to represent the cavitation compliance of your draft tube. Then once you have it, you can calculate, for example, natural frequencies of your system and check if one of the natural frequencies match the excitation frequency. So that, because from the model testing, you know what are the excitation frequency. You already know that it's between 0.2 and 0.4 times the rotational speed. And if you see that you have some natural frequencies in this range, you may think, oh, maybe I'm in trouble. I have at least a risk of resonance. This does not mean you will have it, but you have a risk. Then you can think, OK, if I add some air in it, it means the cavitation compliance will increase and the wave speed will go down. So you can do sensitivity study. We never try to link a wave speed to a given air discharge. I think should be feasible, but we never did the exercise. So at least you can do parametric study, because you have two cases in terms of resonance. Either if you look at the frequency here, you have your natural frequency, F0 here. And either you have your excitation frequency, which is somewhere here. If you inject some air, your natural frequency may go down, and everything gets worse. You start from partial resonance to full resonance. This is also why sometimes people inject some air, and it's even worse. And it sometimes it's hard to understand, but you can explain it through this simple explanation. So air does not always solve everything. Or to solve the problem, maybe you need a lot of air to put the resonance here. But nowadays, I have a hard time to link to a discharge value. The other situation is the good one is maybe your excitation is here. Your resonance is here. If you put some air, you move away your resonance frequency from the excitation and everything is solved. This is what happens in the successful cases. But there are also some unsuccessful cases where you make everything worse. So at least you can do sensitivity analysis. You can say, you can at least know on which side of the excitation you are and if adding air will make the thing worse or better. At least these kind of things you can do, I would say. But yeah?
Christopher, if you allow me a comment.
Yeah.
From my experience, I'm working with transient since 35 years.
Yeah, yeah.
I told Dr. Avelan that at the beginning was complicated, then we have a more comfortable tools, then more and more, and we arrived to this. If you allow me the comment, this is the same as our manual calculator, with plus, minus, multiplicar y dividir, we can solve 99% of our functions. And then we need the other scientific calculator for the 1%. This is similar. You have 99% of the problem already solved with the simple tools, simple functions, and when you want to go to this complicated air inundation and so on and so on, this is just the 1%. Don't spend your time on this 1%. Contract a specialist in that case. Use your time for the other 99%. This is my suggestion.
And another comment is that is to say that all the time people say, hey, all this is old stuff, it's magic technology, blah, 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 blah. And this is Kirchhoff law, and we know the propagation is the signal equation. Easy. Except that it's a system which is fully nonlinear. When you look at the yield chart, the characteristics of the power plant, of the turbine, is fully nonlinear. The physics inside is fully non-linear, and you have a coupling, which means that you have the three ingredients which make the things very complicated. It's depending on the case. That means that you need to have a lot of value, a lot of parameters to be known for the behavior of the machines. Last time we had an issue with the pump turbine, world-class manufacturer, designed world-class pump turbine, in tremendous efficiency. They do all the model testing and so forth. And when they come to the prototype for the commissioning, impossible to find out the right closing loop for the emergency shutdown. And it's something because of the S. And why the S was important? Because you have influence of cavitation and food. And cavitation and fruit, sometimes you cannot do it in a model test because it will mean too small of a head or something else, and so it will be not so good result. Which means that you need to use the commissioning to find the best closing law under the pressure of the customer, the politician, and so forth, and blah, blah, blah. And so it's very hard. And this is why it's very important that the people and we acknowledge that is a complex problem, that as Carlos says, is 99% okay, the last 1% sometimes can kill you. And so you need to be very careful of that, and that we experts acknowledge that is difficult, and we need to be very modest in order to understand what happened there. Because you have many, many parameters which are interacting, and it's in time, it's transient, it's not at one point stationary, no, it's transient. And you see that, and if you consider a power plant with several units, then you have interaction of all the units together. And then if you have, a short shaft, yes, a short shaft on the tailrest channels and a short shaft on the headwater, which means that you have two pendulum, two time constants, and then the complication, the complexity arises, and so it's very difficult at the end. And so it's why we put so much time in developing this software and making research on this. But this is maybe 1 or 2% of the case.
Mussolini was saying 80-20. Could be this. But you need to be careful with that because you can be capped. Because you pack the search chamber, if you flood the search chamber, all the people will scream and so forth. So it's very, very important. And I would like to congratulate Christophe because you had all the demo. And, even me, I was able to do it.
Ah, good. Ah, cool. Ah, nice. Welcome. Pleasure.
Muchas gracias, Marco. Va a tener live por idea de los profesores de este resto de semana. Mañana estaremos en la biblioteca tercer piso, a la izquierda. Ya los estudiantes que trajeron acá, uno de los docentes, están esperando acá afuera y la obligación es llevarlos al hotel para que descansen. Si quieren salir más tarde, pues avisan dónde van a estar. Medellín es muy bonita, pero como toda ciudad grande, es también de tener cuidado. Si no es que hay muy riesgo, sin necesidad. Entonces, seguimos. Muchas gracias.
Gracias. Gracias.